Well, welcome everyone. You're joining us here on Cultivating Voices Live Poetry. And this is our In Remembrance of Minnie Bruce Pratt and Leslie Feinberg, our special event today with Headmistress Press. We're going to open up with this really stunning slideshow created by Kim Ports Parsons. And then I'll come back and begin our program with our illustrious group of featured writers. Enjoy the slideshow and welcome.
Sandy.
Yes.
If you wouldn't mind, I'm going to stop sharing and I'm going to choose to share this in a slightly different way because I think my computer is experiencing a conflict between Zoom and PowerPoint. So I'm going to share it as the video, okay?
All right.
Rather than the slideshow.
Sure.
So if you go ahead and introduce what we're doing one more time, I'll stop the share and I'll start it again in just a moment.
Absolutely. Well, good afternoon, good evening. Bienvenidos, welcome one and all. Today, it's Cultivating Voices Live Poetry, our special event co-sponsored with Headmistress Press. This is our In Remembrance of Minnie Bruce Pratt and Leslie Feinberg. We are going to begin our program today very shortly with a slideshow. But I want to let you know, we have an incredible, incredible array, really a star show, starfire, whatever you like. That's the best thing that you can think of. That's what this program is today, truly. And this is all in honor, remembrance, reverence of these two lighthouses, these two beacons who done so much in their local, national, international communities. We will be joined with a series of remembrances and readings from, as I said, our beautiful panel of poets today. And I'm mostly going to be able to sit back and listen and really enjoy the program as well. So welcome to all of you joining us here live in our Zoom studio, and those of you who are watching us live on Facebook, and of course, the hundreds of you that watch us weekly on our videos. Before we get started, I want to, of course, thank Risa Denenberg of Headmistress Press, co-founder of Headmistress Press with Mary Miriam, who is one of our featured guests today. Thank Risa for all the work that you've done behind the scenes to make this program possible today. I want to thank Don Krieger and Kim Ports Parsons for all of your support. Our fourth Sunday is usually our Sunday off, and they joined in today. Obviously in support of this really special program that we have lined up for us all today. I want to thank, of course, our incredible readers and our guest speakers today. As I mentioned before the program started here, if I was in a room, and I've been in a room with them individually, most of them in a room individually, and I'm usually beyond starstruck and thrilled to be in the room with one of them. Today, 11 of them are together, and I'm surprised I have not spontaneously combusted, to be honest. If you talk to my mom about how I was before the show, she'll tell you I was a little anxious in the best possible way. I expect everyone will appreciate what we are about to experience, and I'm grateful again to one and all of our readers that are joining us today. And I also would like to thank again the audience for coming out today for this special in remembrance of Minnie Bruce Pratt and Leslie Feinberg. I'm going to turn it over to a slideshow that we have in preparation for today's program, and then we'll get right into our panel of poets. Now move to our speakers today. We will endeavor to bring the slideshow back at the end of the program.
We will come back with that in a moment.
Thank you so much. Well, everyone, as I mentioned, we're going to move along with our readers for today. I'm going to introduce them in small but very grand batches, and get out of the way as much as possible, because really they and Minnie Bruce and Leslie are the true stars of this day together. Our first reader today, she is one of the Headmistress Collectibles Lesbian Trading Cards. I hope you have your card with you, Liz, because I wasn't able to locate my card, but here's Minnie Bruce's card. Here she is. You can order these from Headmistress Press, all these sets of cards. Liz All is a poet living in Holderness, New Hampshire. She teaches writing at Plymouth State University, and she will be followed by Kay Coggin, who is the host of Wednesday Night Poetry, the longest running continuous weekly open mic series in the country. And we owe a debt of gratitude to Kai. Many of the people here in this room, right at the beginning of the pandemic, Kai didn't miss a beat, went right to having her program for the entire US and then went international. And that, I think, inspired us to start, as well as a group out in Ireland. So to our first two readers for today, Liz and Kai, thank you so much.
Thank you. I'm so mad I didn't bring my card. I so rarely get to flash it. Thank you for putting this together. I'm so honored to be involved. It feels important to me to, can you hear me okay, folks? Get a thumbs up. Yeah, thank you. It feels important to me to mark the passing last week of Barbara DeBernard, in whose spring 1996 20th century lesbian literature class, Sandy, Yannone, and I were both enrolled as PhD students at the University of Nebraska-Lincoln. That same semester, spring of 96, Barbara was instrumental in bringing Minnie Bruce and Les Feinberg to UNL for a tremendously affecting and inspiring campus visit. That class and that visit, as well as my varied work and evolving friendship with Barbara, changed my life in ways that have rippled out across the decades. She hooded me for my PhD. More importantly, I'm here in this Zoom and in this world in various ways because of her. I have one short poem by Muriel Rukeyser to start off with, and then three, all three from Magnified. So the Rukeyser poem is called Then. When I am dead, even then, I will still love you. I will wait in these poems. When I am dead, even then, I am still listening to you. I will be still making poems for you out of silence. Silence will be falling into that silence. It is building music. Hourglass. All night, the wind throws sleet against the glass, like the sand stinging our faces and hands. The day the hurricane's tail end lashed us at the beach. Time tumbles us back and forth in its giant hourglass. One night at the beginning, you stood naked in the hall. It was storming outside the window, lightning, hail. You flicker into light, arriving before me once again. Time rattles at our window, time trying to get in. Listening at a closed door. My ear at the corner of your sleeping shoulder, listening at a closed door for what is said behind. Now your breath, rushed, hoarse, your feet push like a treadle machine, like you sewing as a girl, the awkward fit. Now your breath like the huff when you work the scanner, running its thin finger of light across your face. Now, if I can make another like, another as, you will still have breath. One more. Another. You will still be with me somewhere. In these words, where I am listening for you. This book is so tremendous. I can't stand it. This is my last slice from it. Last word. Now I am walking inside the apartment. Back and forth, the end is the beginning, the end. You are dying. I write down your words as fast as I can. They become visible, electric impulse. What if you can never change a word in that sentence again?
I bring you a damp wash rag, other things. No thing is like any other thing. No word is like any other word. There is no other you. The leaving, the bereft word, between us nothing but gesture, back, forth, back, forth. Other people go in and out the door, in and out, down the hall, the smudged rug, sit on the bench by the elevator, up, down. There is no way out to where I want to go with you. No word that will carry us out together.
Thank you.
Thank you, Liz. That was beautiful. My name is Kai Coggin. I just want to start by saying how humbled I feel to share this space and this time and remembering two of my heroes, Minnie Bruce Pratt and Leslie Feinberg. I want to thank Sandy and Risa and Mary and everyone involved, Kim, for putting all of this together. This is truly a full circle moment for me to be here. When I think of Minnie Bruce, one thing that I love about these virtual realms is that we got to hear each other's voices and see each other's faces. And though I might be a little bit blurred because I have rural internet and my Wi-Fi is slow, you can hear my voice. And when I think of Minnie Bruce and when I read her poems, I can hear her voice, that sweet, gentle Southern twang in her voice that is just so beautiful. I'm going to read a Facebook post that kind of morphed into an essay. And it was for me to write on the day, it was actually 3 years ago to the day that she featured on Wednesday Night Poetry. And it was right around the time that Magnified was coming out. And it was such a huge moment for me to have one of my heroes feature for us. And so I wanted to just get it all down on paper. And so I wrote this about why Minnie Bruce and Leslie were both so special to me. Tomorrow night at Wednesday Night Poetry, I'm featuring one of my personal heroes, the eminent poet and activist, Minnie Bruce Pratt. This is a full circle moment for me, and I just want to tell you more about it so you can gain the appreciation and love that I have held in my heart for her over all of these years. I was about 19 or 20, 1999, year 2000, when I encountered her work. I had just been kicked out and expelled from the Corps of Cadets at Texas A&M University for violating the don't ask, don't tell policy and fraternizing and falling in love with a female cadet. I was made an example of, hazed and humiliated in front of 2,000 cadets. It was incredibly damaging emotionally and spiritually. I was lost at sea. Alone, I put on an even tougher armor of extra body weight and masculinity, got called sir by people at work, and made myself appear unapproachable in order to survive future perpetrators of my tender heart, future abuse from the patriarchal system that was threatened by my very existence. I hid in the physical picture of a boy, dressed like one, smoked my cigarettes and drank beers like one. I numbed myself. I hardened. I survived. I got an apartment. I stayed at the university and changed my major to creative writing and poetry. I had some stories to tell and I wanted to learn how to tell them. I remember it was the first day of my History of Modern American Women class, the feminist literature class, my junior year. And the professor started by asking a question. Okay, class, before we begin, what is history? I answered without being called upon in my typical sardonic manner. It's the story that's told by the winners. I had already at such a young age understood the depths of my otherness, and being on the wrong side of history and societal norms, navigating a dangerous world where I would most certainly always be on the losing end. The professor made me repeat my answer, louder for everyone in the back, and she wrote it on the board with a sort of proud smirk on her face as if to say, oh yeah, we've got a live one here. I remember the name of the professor now as I write this. I wish I remembered her name to thank her for the liberated seeds that she planted in my broken heart. In that class, I was introduced to the writing of Minnie Bruce Pratt and her collection of prose, She. She was one of the five novelists of nonfiction for the 1995 American Library Association's Gay, Lesbian, and Bisexual Book Award. When I read that book, I felt like someone was telling my story for once, a reflection of myself that I had never seen in any pages. When my parents divorced and my father said, take care of your mother and sister for me, the little seven-year-old girl took on the burdens of a man. Later at age 10 and 11, I noticed that my attractions were only for girls, never boys. I hid that secret for many years during my Catholic adolescence, but still fell deeply in love with a girl at 17. My first love. And reading She, I felt seen, held in the love poems of that book, in the words and interactions that were painted, in the feminine loving the feminine. Next, we read the groundbreaking work, Stone Butch Blues by Leslie Feinberg, said to be one of the most influential pieces of literature in the queer canon, especially for lesbian and bisexual women. It was like all of a sudden, I was not alone in the world. Reading the pages of that book was like reading a part of myself, a butch lesbian, how I identified at the time, struggling and triumphing through life and love, bending genders and definitions of what it meant to be a woman loving another woman. It was also the first account of the transgender experience I had ever come into contact with in academia. It was a visceral experience. It opened up my world, broadened my circle of understanding, and gave me hope. After reading those two books, the professor told us that Minnie Bruce and Leslie were lovers, a couple, partners in life. I was blown away. Two powerful writers, loving each other proudly, writing their lesbian experiences with such passion and vigor, now taught in my conservative college's classroom. It was life-altering to think of them. It gave me hope that one day I would be out of the confines of this conservative cage in which I had chosen to receive my higher education, and that one day I would finally be able to be myself, free to live and love who and how I would choose. I held that close. Their love saved me. Their love gave me hope. We read Rita Mae Brown and Jeanette Winterson and many others, but it was the love story between Minnie Bruce and Leslie that stayed in my imagination and heart for the remainder of that semester and beyond. Like a gay North Star, I dreamed of one day being a writer and writing about the woman that I would love. I dreamed of poems written in the shape of my lover's mouth. And I owe those poems to Minnie Bruce and to Leslie and their enduring love, an example of honesty, justice, community, and holding each other as examples for all of us to be our fullest selves. Thank you for listening to that. I know that was long, but I could write and write and write about Minnie Bruce. So when she decided that she would appear on Wednesday Night Poetry, we had made a plan that after the pandemic was over, she was gonna come to Hot Springs and feature in person. And she was going to come to my house and we were gonna chat over tea. And it's bittersweet that never happened, but I do feel her always with me. If you'd permit, I'd like to also read a couple of poems from Magnified that really speak to me. The first is Saved Voice Messages. And my bookmark is from a little card that she mailed me. And so it's like a piece of her, you know, from her is in this book. Saved Voice Messages. The automated voice says 21 days to erase. All of your calls are filled into some cyber drawer. The one about the eagle, the ones about the snow, the miner strike, Mumia, student protests in Arizona. The one when you say, don't mind that errand, come home and get loved up. The one when you hope the bus ride wasn't rough. You fold all your electromagnetic energy into the digital envelope and send yourself to me. The last one, when you sound so sick. I hit save, 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 but I can't save everything. Today I have 11 messages of us traveling through time together when there is yet no end. In the end, what is left to say? In the end, you died. And with your last mouthful of breath, you carried away the person you had been. You took away the person I was with you. At the end, you said, this time I know I am going and you are staying. But somehow, unknown to me, was the one who survived, saying, if only we were still alive. Thank you.
That's Kai Coggin and Liz All. Thank you to you both. This is our In Remembrance of Minnie Bruce Pratt and Leslie Feinberg. And I'll just say briefly that, as Liz mentioned, I also was in that lesbian literature class. We read Stone Butch Blues. And again, it was a life-altering experience for me as well. And I imagine that many of you in the room today here have the stories that are about the significance of Minnie Bruce Pratt and Leslie Feinberg in your lives. We could fill days and days and days with these stories. One thing I wanted to mention before we move on to our next set of readers, I was thinking so much about how, because Minnie Bruce and Leslie were of a particular generation, we're going to see in the slideshow at the end of our program, after Julie Marie Wade, we'll watch the slideshow, you'll see them at protest after protest after protest. These two were the consummate activists, but they weren't just activists. They began movements. They began the movements that many of us in this room participate in. They were there, they started them. That is the legacy that we're honoring today for our In Remembrance of Minnie Bruce Pratt and Leslie Feinberg. Our next five readers will be Chinny Chen. Chinny Chen is a genderqueer Chinese American hybrid writer, community organizer, and teacher. There's the card to prove it from the Lesbian Trading Card series of Headmistress Press. Next will be Suzanne Gardiner. Suzanne lives in Brooklyn and teaches at Sarah Lawrence College. And I am going to do something that I don't often do. I'm going to go off script. That's a lie. I go off script all the time. You don't have this book called The New World. Go get it. Here's a book that changed my life. There's Liz nodding. She knows it changed my life and it changed hers as well. Our next reader will be the unbelievable J.P. Howard. Talk about life changers. Everyone in this room, oh my gosh. J.P. Howard is a Cave Canem Fellow. graduate fellow and the curator of Women Writers in Bloom Poetry Salon, well over a decade there in Brooklyn, New York. I encourage you to either drop by in Brooklyn when you're there or attend one of the hybrid events. Incredible, incredible, incredible series. And following JP will be Jenny Johnson. Jenny Johnson is an assistant professor of creative writing at West Virginia University and is on the faculty of the Rainier Writing Workshop, Pacific Lutheran University's Low Residency MFA program. And rounding out this particular set, we will have a little musical accompaniment from Yeva Johnson. Yeva Johnson is a multi-talented poet, musician, writer, and artist, and that is an understatement. Thank you so much, Jenny Chen.
Hi, everyone. Thank you so much, Liz and Kai, for your stories and sharings. And thank you, Sandy and Risa, for organizing this. And I'm just really grateful to be here in the circle. So I was listening. I was feeling really jealous because I never took a queer lit or trans lit class. I actually met Minnie Bruce Pratt and Leslie Feinberg in the pages. Through their writing, I never actually got a chance to meet either of them, but they have been really important writers to me. I'm gonna read excerpts from an essay of Minnie Bruce Pratt's called Poetry in Time of War. I can't read the whole thing because it's too long. And it's in a book called Rebellion Essays 1980 to 1991. And I chose this because I'm non-binary. I'm a co-parent with my partner, who's a trans woman, and our two kids came out in the last few years as non-binary and trans. And it has been a very challenging time to be a parent and a parent of trans and non-binary youth being targeted right now in the country. And I felt like this parts of this essay spoke to this activist spirit. Also because it spoke to a time in the 90s that I remember, protesting against the Iraq War. And also because it spoke to solidarity. I'm just gonna read excerpts of it, and I encourage everyone to read the full thing. And thank you for having me. In the second week of the war, I speak at a local university, part of a poetry series with a theme from Shelley's statement, "Poets are the unacknowledged legislators of the world." I look out over the half-filled auditorium and see friends, former students, and lining the back rows, uniformed young men and women from the Naval Academy, sent by an English instructor to get an evening's worth of culture. This evening, they get me. I say to them, as a lesbian poet, I have been contemplating Shelley's words. To be a poet who is a lesbian is to be a potential felon in half the states of this country, in the District of Columbia, where I live. In some countries of the world, to be a lesbian poet is to be subject by law to imprisonment or even execution. How I love is outside the law. And when I write and speak of my life as a lesbian, my poems have also been seen as outside the bounds of poetry. It has taken me years to call myself a poet. I am a woman who stopped writing in her early 20s, when my imagination faltered before the poets my teachers offered to emulation, the white male writers of my region, the poets who glorified the values of the Old South, who gave in the lyric beauty of their poems, the literary equivalent of laws that kept women in their place Blacks in their place, and those of us with perverted love entirely hidden. To me, then, poets looked and acted very much like legislators, two sets of upper-class white men, the legislators in control of public communal space, the poets endorsing their world or some few locked in isolated reaction to it. When I began living as a lesbian, I had no place in that world of legislators and poets except as a criminal. I had to create a new reality, find in hidden lives the bittersweet kernel of possibility, and bring that in my hands, on my tongue, to being. I was able to emerge as a poet and a lesbian only because a place had been opened to me through creative organizing and acts of individual courage by lesbian and gay people over the last 20 years, as well as through the larger civil rights and liberation movements in this country. In those movements, there has been a vision and a dream of a place without domination, without injustice authorized by law. I can say because of that dream, I have become a poet. Not one who offers alternative legislation, but one who offers possibility, threatening to some, desired by others, but possibility. The audience is very quiet. I read some poems, one based on the laws used against lesbians to take our children away from us, as had happened to me. I say I'm worried about my children being taken away from me now by the war. I read a poem in which the father asks his son not to go to war. The father who says to the son, it is time to rebel, but do not leave alone. Talk to the others. A poem written because of how in the father's world, the voice of the mother, the woman, the lesbian, is almost never heard, or if heard, is dismissed as unrealistic, hysterical, irrational. I read a prayer poem for my sons, a wish for blessings on them. I say that I believe my greatest gift to my children has been my decision to live openly as a lesbian, an example of personal integrity, the possibility that they can decide to live differently as men. And then she, I'm gonna skip a little bit. She goes on to talk about being attacked by Jesse Helms. And so this part, I'm going to read just a little bit. At first, I felt disbelief when Helms began to attack my writing directly, along with the work of Christos of the Menominee Nation and Audre Lorde, two lesbians of color who had also received NEA grants. In a letter to the General Accounting Office, he named us by name, together with several performance artists and some arts organizations, as examples of the misuse of federal money in funding quote-unquote obscene art. His request for an investigation by the Comptroller General began, first of all, because of the nature of the enclosed material. I urge that great care be taken to assure that your woman associates not be exposed to the material. It seemed that the only reason Christos, Audrey, and I were included in this investigation was that we publicly acknowledge ourselves to be lesbians and poets. According to the right-wing promoters of quote-unquote traditional values, our love was obscene, our very being was obscene, therefore, our writing must be obscene. And then just the last part I'm going to read is this little snippet of a conversation with Audre Lorde. When I talked to Audre about the attacks on our writing and my fears, she said yes. That events now reminded her of living through the 1950s, but we must keep doing our work. What the censors wanted was to keep us from our work. My work, to question out loud, to write the not yet spoken words, shifting back and forth, waiting for the elevator so I can go back to my students. I think about protection, domination, perversion in poetry. And I wanted to repeat that line as my ending. My work, to question out loud, to write the not yet spoken words. Thank you all so much.
No, I'm good.
Hi. I'm so honored and moved to be here. Thank you to all headmistresses. And thank you so much to Liz and to Kai and to Chingin. That was so beautiful, what came before. I'm gonna, because we're all sort of writing the same poem this afternoon, I'm gonna also read from an essay. I wrote down what I wanted to say because I kept crying while I was doing it. So I thought, okay, write it down. As I've been thinking of Minnie Bruce and missing her since she passed, I've been thinking that the first place I ever heard her voice wasn't in poems, but in a book called Yours in Struggle, Three Feminist Perspectives on Anti-Semitism and Racism, which Firebrand published in 1984. And just having a moment of gratitude for the magazines where I did glimpse her name in that time, in that world of presses where all our voices were for a time. Some of them are still here and some gone. Icon, which is the first place I ever published a poem. Sinister Wisdom, Persephone Press, Crossing Press, Spinsters on Loot. Bless the world they made, that way out of no way that I had the luck to come up instructed and held by. Long Hall Press in Brooklyn in 1982, when I was 21, published Jan Clausen's pamphlet called A Movement of Poets. And bless the Lesbian Poetry Archive that's preserved somebody's marked up copy of it so that you can find it on the internet as a PDF. I'm smiling to think of what PDF might have meant to us then. How about Pretty Damn Fine? That's what Minnie Bruce was. So this book Yours in Struggle came out when I was 23. And I came to poetry and to being a human being through the world that it helped to frame, a world in which something was possible that needs a new name now, maybe, but then we called it a sisterhood. I'm just gonna read some fragments from it. It starts with a collective voice because the book was made Minnie Bruce with Barbara Smith and with Ellie Balkin. I like to tell Sarah Lawrence students about Ellie Balkin's work with a group called DARE, Dykes Against Racism Everywhere. So the collective voice starts, Yours in Struggle happened because we were able to talk to each other in the first place. Despite our very different identities and backgrounds, each of us speaks only for herself and we do not necessarily agree with each other. Yet we believe our cooperation on this book indicates concrete possibilities for coalition work. And this is Minnie Bruce's voice. And really the voice that helped to make me. I understood that I had been lied to by government leaders, teachers, preachers, and my parents. And I dedicated myself to unlearning what I had been taught. When I walked three blocks in a slightly different direction down Maryland Avenue to go to my lover's house, I passed yards of Black folks, the yard of the lady who keeps children with its blue and red windmill, its roses of Sharon, the yard of the man who delivers vegetables with its stacked slatted crates, the yard of the people next to the Righteous Branch Commandment Church of God, Seventh Day, with its tomatoes in the summer, its collards in the fall. In the summer, folks sit out on their porches or steps or sidewalks. When I walk by, if I lift my head and look toward them and speak, hey, they may speak, say hey, or how you doing, or perhaps just nod. In the spring, I was afraid to smile when I spoke because that might be too familiar. But by the end of the summer, I had walked back and forth so often I was familiar. So sometimes we shared comments about the mean weather. And then she goes back to her own building to meet Mr. Boone, the janitor, who doesn't raise his eyes to mine or his head when we speak. He's a dark red-brown man from the Yemisee in South Carolina, that swampy land of Native American resistance and armed communities of fugitive slaves, that marshy land at the headwaters of the Cumbie, once site of enormous rice plantations and location of Harriet Tubman's successful military action that freed many slaves. When we meet in the hall or in the elevator, even though I may have just heard him speaking in his own voice to another man, he yes ma'ams me in a sing song. I hear my voice replying in that horrid, cheerful accent of a white lady. And I hate my white womanhood that drags between us the long, bitter history of our region. I'm trying to learn how to live, to have the speaking to extend beyond the moment's word, to act so as to change the unjust circumstances that keep us from being able to speak to each other. I'm trying to get a little closer to that longed for but unrealized world where we each are able to live, but not by trying to make someone less, not by someone else's blood or pain. Yes, that's what I'm trying to do with my living now. And of course, that's what she did. Jan Clausen in that pamphlet talks about, she says, perhaps most difficult to grasp about the situation of the pre-feminist woman poet is the isolation in which she worked. And Minnie Bruce and her sisters made a way for my poet's life that meant that that wasn't true for me. And that when I was writing, it wasn't for Shakespeare or Eliot or Gary Snyder or even Elizabeth Bishop. It was Minnie Bruce and her sisters who I was writing for then and who I feel listening still. This is from I'm going to end with three little blasts from emails. This is from Marilyn Hacker. Do you and Minnie Bruce know each other? There is something parallel to me in the way you were both doing something too political or the wrong kind of political in your writing. I think it's far more threatening because the work is so good as poetry. You must have read Minnie Bruce's Inside the Money Machine. Fucking brilliant, in my humble opinion. And this is me to Minnie Bruce. Dear Minnie Bruce, Marilyn's note reminded me that I've only written you in my mind, I think, to tell you that in the whirlwind of last month, I involuntarily sat down and read your Sinister Wisdom poems straight through. They stopped me. So beautiful. Everything that's real, that's connected to that big current of life and death, without lies, is always precious. But somehow now in this shitstorm, it shines even more. The way your poems did and do, a great gift to all of us and to the ones who'll come later who'll read them. Gracias. Abrazo, Suzanne. And I'll finish with hers to me. Suzanne, thank you so much for that lovely message. Life has been very hard after Leslie died. I started the poems during her long illness, and they have given me some comfort working with them since. Death does have a way of calling the question on what is truthful. I'm glad their truth gave you some comfort too, especially in this difficult time. I post poems, often from this sequence, every Thursday on my Facebook page. So there are more there. Yours in the struggle, Minnie Bruce. Thank you.
Thank you, everybody. That was so beautiful, so moving, everything that I've heard so far. Of course, I want to thank Cultivating Voices and Headmistress Press for organizing us all together today. And of course, to our co-hosts, Sandy and Lisa. I deeply admired how Minnie and Leslie both showed up in the world, particularly for community and also for each other. So today I've chosen to share Pratt's poem titled Poem for My Sons. I believe it was written in 1987 and from her collection Crime Against Nature, which was published in 1988. I was only Facebook friends with her, but clearly had followed her work for many years. And on Facebook, for those who know, she would often publish her thoughts and many times her poems each week. So I'm going to share her public post from actually September 22nd, 2022, which is almost exactly a year ago when I went back to look and find it. And then I'm going to read her poem for my sons. I think it's important to be able to hear, to visualize her powerful post along with her poem. Her post documents how she lost custody of her two sons in 1977. And I had known the story, but to read her post firsthand really affected me because 20 years later in 1997, my now wife and then partner and I would have the first of our two sons. And I knew that Pratt felt the same deep love my wife and I felt for our two sons. And I could only imagine how she survived that experience and continued to hold on to love. So I'm just going to begin by sharing, it's a short post, but her post from Facebook from September 22nd, 2022. And it says, "This poem is how we win with hope, because in 1977, the state of North Carolina and my ex-husband took my young children from me because I lived openly as a lesbian. And through love and struggle, my children, their spouses, 5 grandchildren, and I are still together 45 years later, part of extended family and communities of many genders, sexualities, nationalities, abilities, languages, musics, and hope." I'm now going to read the poem, and it's called Poem for My Sons, that was published in 1987. "When you were born, all the poets I knew were men, dads eloquent on their sleeping babes and the future, Coleridge at midnight, Yeats' prayer that his daughter lack opinions, his son be high and mighty, think and act. You read the new father's loud eloquence, fiery sparks written in a silent house, breathing with the mother's exhausted sleep. When you were born, my first, what I thought was milk, my breasts sore, engorged, but not enough when you woke. With you, my youngest, I did not think, my head unraised for 3 days, mind dead from waist down anesthetic labor, saddle block, no walking either. Your father was then the poet I'd ceased to be when I got married. It's taken me years to write this to you. I had to make a future, willful, voluble, lascivious, a thinker, a long walker, unstruck transgressor, furious, shouting, voluptuous, a lover, a smeller of blood, milk, a woman mean as she can be some nights, existence I could pray to, capable of poetry. Now, here we are. You are men, and I am not the woman who rocked you in the sweet reek of penicillin, sour milk, the girl who could not imagine herself or future more than a warm walled room, had no words but the pap of the unexpected. And so those nights could not wish for you. But now I have spoken myself. I can ask for you that you'll know evil when you smell it, that you'll know good and do it and see how both run loose through your lives, that then you'll remember you come from dirt and history, that you'll choose memory, not anesthesia, that you'll have work you love, hindering no one, a path crossing at boundary markers where you question power, that your loves will match you thought for thought, and that long heat of blood and fact of bone. Words not so romantic nor so grandly tossed as if I'd summon the universe to be at your disposal. I can only pray that you'll never ask for the weather, earth, angels, women, or other lives to obey you, that you'll remember me who crossed, recrossed you as a woman making slowly toward an unknown place where you could be with me like a woman on foot in a long stepping out." Thank you, y'all.
Thank you, JP. Really moving. Thanks, Sandy and Lisa, and to Cultivating Voices and Headmistress Press. I'm so honored to be here. When I read Stone Butch Blues as a baby Butch, it changed my life. But I've been revisiting She, and I've been thinking about the impact that femmes have had on my life, and how much I've learned about gender, power, shame, the ethics of Eros, and unabashed desire. So I'm gonna read 2 hot excerpts from this book. The first one is Fist. She pushes her fingers into my mouth. As we lie side by side on the bed, and I begin to suck. I want her whole hand inside my mouth, like a hand in my cunt, but a different kind of fisting. With each finger, she teases my tongue as if fingering my clit. All of my consciousness is on the tip of my tongue where her forefinger touches. I eat her hand, trying to get more and more of it deep into my mouth. How much can I take without gagging? I want her hand to reach down into my stomach and grab, wring out some painful emotion, not love, but something close. My mouth fills with this, a kind of sex I haven't understood. Delicately, I bite each of her fingers and the flesh web between. I could clench my jaw and break each slender bone. My tongue rests on her palm. The grooved lines there may mean long life or broken hearts. I don't try to read the enigmatic script as I take her hand down to where I devour everything. Woo! So I'll just read one more. This one's called Marks. She took my foot in her lap and circled my ankle with a bit of slender, twisted leather, an anklet like girls wore when I was in high school, except this one was a souvenir from a women's music festival. Sliding her fingers lightly over the skin of my ankle bone, she spoke of her distaste for permanent marks. She said, "I don't wish to do anything with you that is a mark of possession." I described to her the tattoo I wanted, perhaps a snake writhing from my wrist up my arm, perhaps a blue geometric bracelet. I argued with her about marks. I said that we make them, alphabet or tattoos, as a human act to place the self in time and location. If my beloved agrees to my teeth on her neck, then the tiny bruise is like a poem written to join the self passionately to another. The mark only becomes a trap when we begin to use it to save ourselves, when the wedding ring becomes a gold coin to buy security, eternity. Then we fix the other with an X, mark the spot, stay the same, be mine forever. We become unable to possess and then relinquish. In this long abstract conversation, neither of us said we were talking about sex. I did not speak of my need to be completely taken by a lover, how I wanted the fiery print of her hands everywhere on me, inside and out. Later, after she'd returned to her home, she sent me a packet of peel-on wash-off tattoos, roses with thorns, salamanders, little dragons breathing fire. "You are lying on top of me at the end of our first week together. And we are playing at being 16, having forbidden sex. I feel the edge of your teeth as you kiss my neck roughly, as you cry out, 'I want to mark you. I want to. I am panting. Go ahead, bite me, bite me.' With my hand, I pull your head toward me. You groan, 'I want to, but I can't. I can't. I want to.' I taunt you. I urge you on. You know I am going to another lover soon, but only I know there will be time for the marks to fade. I say, 'Mark me.' And you bend to my neck in an agony of desire and conscience. I am unscrupulous. I beg you for possession against your principles. You lie on me again and say, 'I don't want her to touch you. I don't want her to have your mouth. My God, to have your mouth.' I lie quietly under you. I listen. I say nothing, but silently I admit to myself that I want this from you, to be claimed by you. The next day you say, 'I want to possess you, not own you.' Later, over the phone, back in your city, far away. You tell me, when I first kissed you, I felt how you protected your heart. You say, I'm coming back to kiss you again. You will open your mouth to me, and I will touch your heart with my tongue. The invisible mark your lips, teeth, tongue will leave on me. By the time we have this conversation, the marks on my neck, the bruises are fading. I have called my other lover to tell her I am never coming to her bed again. Thanks.
That was super fun. Thank you. Thank you so much, Sandy and Risa, for extending an invitation to read with this wonderful panel, and to Headmistress Press and Cultivating Voices Live. I never had a chance to meet Leslie Feinberg or Minnie Bruce Pratt, but was a participant in some literary Zoom groups with Minnie Bruce Pratt, and I too have two sons. Today, I'll be reading three poems from Minnie Bruce Pratt's collections, Crime Against Nature and Magnified, in memory of both Minnie Bruce Pratt and Leslie Feinberg. And I, as I usually do, will start and end with music. Another question. One, yes, they've seen these poems. The oldest says nothing yet. It's his voice I've answered in them, often, since the night he asked me about his father. How did it happen? I tell the sorry story again to him, a grown-up man. His words slide stone from the cave's mouth, and we enter together to ask and answer questions never voiced before. A chill, a crinkle of skin, as we advance into a place unknown toward the oracle of ourselves. Now he visits, we talk, go do strange things. In the backyard, a heavy rain one night. We squat by the garden in the porch's light sun to watch the earthworms rise, writhe, huge as monsters in a tiny odyssey. We lean over and, like gods, admire the fabulous worms. Two, the youngest son is debonair, modern, reads Yeats, loves political words. I pick him up from a summer job, midnight in the steam heat of hot asphalt and the public fountain. He's reading in the aqueous light, gives me a dreamy traveling smile from a place where he plots a clever footing of words. One morning, he reads my poems, serious, and says he likes best what he remembers being in, perhaps like this one. And also that I get in the middle and tell it all, grab people and tell them, just say it. Yes, they've seen the poems. The world prefers I not tell the children. Hide, be oblique, be secret, be grotesque. But the youngest says, when I tell it all, that's what he likes best. And this is Hargrove Scholes. The habit of living taken away, the green chalked with white dust, like grief, like death on the way to the river. To lose a person like you who can say the eternal nature of changing matter, who longs to go ahead to see who will be on earth in a year, in a million years. The sun overthrows the cool. The river struggles with the shoals and breathes out the rapids. Breathes out, out. The river breathes in so quietly I can't hear. To lose a person like you who can say the terrible beauty. If you were here, you'd see how the coal dust rhymes the river edge in blacked sand. You'd see the lump lunch miners drinking beer in the shade, panting for their breath. The people who just drove up, their child runs down to the worn shoals, broad as a spillway, and says, "We can wade in the shadows, or maybe shadows." Everything is in motion. The leaf shadows hurry. Everything is in motion here at Hargrove Shoals. The wind begins to make its afternoon way down the river. The child counts to see how many times. 53 times. There is no before and no after. Eternal nature of changing matter. The terrible beauty. And this last poem is cut off from things outside. The red veins bleeding in the green leaves, the green veins in the white bones of grass, in the mist of a breath of sun, the sudden bee, how we work, 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 not our nectar. No death overcome that way. The hope for a fleeting look, to be even briefly seen. The wave, the road crew's hand. You, go ahead, go on by me. Thank you so much.
I'm so like taken by it all. I forget I have to actually return and do something on the program. Oh my gosh, falling down as the host, but really it's bowing down to everything that has transpired here this afternoon, evening, wherever you, dear audience members, are joining us from. Thank you so, so much. So, so much. Chinning Chen, Suzanne Gardiner, JP Howard, Jenny Johnson, and Yeva Johnson, who will be joining us in our October New Book Showcase. Congratulations. We're so looking forward to seeing your new collection. Well, our final group, it's as I'm sitting here listening, I'm also thinking, oh, let's do tributes to everybody. Like, let's do a tribute to Audre Lorde. Let's do a tribute to Adrienne Rich. Let's bring all the foremothers in front of us and praise them together. So anybody wants to kind of do some of that work with me, contact me off. And we'll get some things cooking here further. I know some of you are gonna take me up on that. It's a genuine offer. I'll say also, as we continue here in our remembrance of Minnie Bruce Pratt and Leslie Feinberg, those poems from Crime Against Nature in particular, I remember reading the book when I was in graduate school. I had it on my PhD comprehensive exam list. transgender warrior would not come out until after I had received my degree. But again, this book, which is now in a new revised edition, if you haven't seen it yet, the new revised edition, also changed my thinking dramatically. And I give it to students. I buy extra copies of it, hand it to people whenever I can. It reminds me that we were talking about Barbara DiBernard a little earlier at the top of the show with Liz. She was our professor that Brandon Tina was murdered in Lincoln, Nebraska, we were living there. Liz and I were in the program living there. And I went down to Kansas City, and Minnie Bruce and Leslie were there along with Kate Bornstein. And I'm gonna blank on, and there were a number of other folks there at the beginning of the trial of those people who murdered Brandon Tina, that would become the movie, The Boys Don't Cry, and there's documentaries there. And it was one of a very early gathering of transgender warriors. And I feel so fortunate to have learned from them that day. And all the things, I'll say one little other anecdote, because we've been talking a little bit about Butch Femme here today as well. I had two amazing moments, and they might seem trivial, but when I say them, I think you'll understand why I hold them in my heart very dearly. I ran into Leslie at the Outright conference that used to happen in Boston, and she complimented me on my tie. Holy mackerel. Right? And then the other time, I was with my then girlfriend, and Minnie Bruce comes up to me and she's like, oh yeah, you two look really good together. I mean, these two, one of the most stunning couples I've seen, except some of the folks that I see, the couples here on Cultivating Voices. I won't name names, but maybe later I will. Some of you, most stunning couples, I love your posts about your anniversaries and things like that. Beautiful, beautiful. So grief and joy are always holding hands, and I've felt it today. In our last set, I expect we will hear more of that same sentiment of grief and joy holding hands. We're going to hear from Kecha Kuipers, who is the current editor of Poetry Northwest, my very recent former stomping grounds. So glad to have you here, and thank you for that work that you're doing. Mary Miriam, co-founder of Headmistress Press, and is the founder and editor of Lavender Review, at Lesbian Poetry and Art. I hope all of you will have read and contributed, and will contribute to that journal that continues to do its amazing work in the world of art and letters. Kitty Sue is an American poet, the author of the groundbreaking Words of a Woman Who Breathes Fire, Breathless, Erotica and Sparks Fly. And she is also the subject of Nice Chinese Girls Don't, a documentary short from award-winning director Jennifer Avone. And finally, we'll round out the program today with Julie Marie Wade, who's a professor at Florida University in Miami, where she teaches poetry, memoir, lyric essay, and hybrid forms to graduate and undergraduate students. Thank you to the four of you. Welcome.
It's so amazing to be here. And it just like almost makes me cry from the moment I start speaking. So bear with me. But I think, you know, getting to hear each of you talk about what Minnie and Leslie have meant to you, it just brings so much of it back for me. I mean, Kai, talking about that, how this is a full circle moment, it feels that way to me too. Qingyan used the word solidarity. JP talked about being a mother. Jenny talked about, you know, that like seeing the self as butch or femme and what we can learn from each of those identities, right? And all of that. I think sometimes when you first encounter a writer on the page and you see yourself in what they've written, you not only are seeing yourself, you're getting to understand how where you are in this constellation of selves. And all of the people that you sort of share that giant sparkling, you know, presence with. And I think for me, that was something that happened the first time that I read Minnie Bruce Pratt's work and Leslie's work as well. And it happened for me, like some of you have said, when I was young and when I was finding myself as a queer person, I was in college, it was the 90s. I mean, I think about, that was where I met my wife in college. And I think about how scared we were to find ourselves as queer people then, and the incredibly circuitous path it took for us to now find ourselves, you know, married and with two beautiful children. And so many of the questions that I asked myself then, and then I asked myself over the years, and then I ask myself even now sometimes is, am I queer enough? And what makes me queer enough? And when I read Minnie's work, those questions go away. I want to read the first poem of hers that I ever encountered. It's called The Blue Cup, and it's from her book, Walking Back Up Depot Street. Through binoculars, the spiral nebula was a smudged white thumbprint on the night sky. Stories said it was a mark left by the hand of night, that old she easily weaving the universe out of milky strings of chaos. Beatrice found creation more difficult. Tonight, what she had was greasy water whirling in the bottom of her sink, revolution and one clean cup. She set the blue cup down on the table, spooned instant coffee, poured boiling water, a thread of sweetened milk. Before she went back to work, she drank the galaxy that spun small and cautious between her chapped, cupped hands. Yeah, I think that idea of enough and enough, when I think about her work, I think about how it's so radically guided by love, that even when it is full of anger, that anger comes from a place of love. So I'm going to read a poem of anger as well. Justice, come down. A huge sound waits, bound in the ice, in the icicle roots, in the buds of snow on fir branches, in the falling silence of snow, glittering in the sun, brilliant as a swarm of gnats, nothing but hovering wings at midday. With the sun comes noise. Tongues of ice break free, fall, shatter, splinter, speak. If I could write the words, simple, like turning a page to say, write what happened. But this means a return to the cold place where I am being punished, alone to the stony circle where I am frozen, the empty space, children, mother, father gone, lover gone away. There, grief still sits and waits, grim, numb, keeping company with anger. I can smell my anger like sulfur struck matches. I wanted what had happened to be a wall to burn, a window to smash. At my fist, the pieces would sparkle and fall. All would be changed. I would not be alone. Instead, I have told my story over and over. At parties, on the edge of meetings, my life clenched in my fist, my eyes brittle as glass. Ashamed, people turned their faces away from the woman ranting, asking, "Justice, stretch out your hand. Come down, glittering, from where you have hidden yourself away." I'm gonna finish with just one short poem. And this poem appeared in Minnie Bruce's book, Magnified, her last book. But first it appeared in this issue of Poetry Northwest, which was the first issue where I was editor in chief. And it, you know, every time you get to publish one of your idols, I published a poem by Marilyn Hacker a couple of years ago as well. And when you get to publish one of your idols, somebody who you've gotten to read their work and not only feel that mirror and that constellation, but also to hold them up as somebody, I think somebody said, mentioned in the chat, the word validate, right? Like, this person has validated my life. So these beautiful poems, I love this book, Magnified. And again, I feel like radically guided by love, and like love as the most political thing that we can do and be. So this is our poem, The Ledge. Wind drags the voices of the dead, howling over the metal window ledge, the harmonica of what's left unsaid. What's the use of poetry? Not one word comes back to talk me out of pain. I go out to hear the music, and there is nothing until almost the end. Then the giant drumming feet as night escapes in cool flight. And then the blaze, the brass, the sun comes back. The only eye stares back into mine. A voice, mine, is saying, "I stayed to the very end, that I remember." Thank you.
I'm going to start with a quote from an interview at Lambda Literary about her book, Magnified. Minnie Bruce Pratt said, quote, "You can say to yourself that you understand time, death, partings, but the body only wants the person back. The body is like a faithful dog waiting at the closed door that the beloved person has walked through. The body just waits and waits and howls for the person to come back. You can't tell the body with words that the person will never come back. The body doesn't believe it. My body still doesn't believe that Leslie will never come back to me. There's no letting go with the body. What I've learned now at the end of these poems is only time and sometimes poetry helps the body carry the grief." And in a Cultivating Voices program, Minnie Bruce said, quote, "Poems can help us want to stay alive." I'm going to read three poems that I published by Minnie Bruce in the Lavender Review. The Wood Thrush Sings, a poem for those burdened and wakeful at night. At the end of the day, at the beginning of night, you lift the bed cover so I can climb in by. The bed is a cave, the sheets cool as limestone, except where you've warmed the warp and weft. The bed is a nest we fold ourselves into, belly to back, knee to knee fold, wrist bone to bone. Our ribs make a boat of the bed to carry us to a land of dreams, to what will happen next.
At 3 a.m., I wake up, maybe the IRS, the taxes, or room after room unpacking hundreds of boxes. If I put each thing in its place, there will be a place for the boat to land where the clock doesn't tick, where the body is unlocked from pain, where the wood thrush sings after rain. This one's called The Moon Reading. The moon looks in on our bedroom window at us sometimes. As I lie down beside you, she pulls a silvery sheet over us and then retreats to her nighttime reading, east to west. Night after night, that bright gaze moves over us, lying under the comfort of being watched over. The round illuminated magnifying glass in Mama's hand as she passed into dementia and understood less and less, her anxious eyes reading the same line over and over. The moon that shone in my window when I was little and supposed to have religion. So I knelt and prayed to that light because she looked back at me. Everything earthly and imperfect changes under the moon. In this moment beside you, I am perfectly happy, lying in the moonlight, drifting slowly with you into illegible sleep. And the last one I'll read is called The Place Lost and Gone, The Place Found. One low yellow light, the back room a cave, musty sleeping bags, us huddled on the floor. We pretend we're camped somewhere with no calendar, distant from morning when I will leave and leave them motherless children again. The oldest travels into sleep, holds my hand while I listen, left, to a huge wind come up in my hollow ears, my breath, pain, and me asking, what are we besides this pain, this frail momentary clasp? At the window next day, the face of the youngest stiff with grief, and at my desk beside me years after, his face clear, fixed, like a photo set in a paperweight, crystal heavy pain. Pick it up, unable to put it down. Yet woven, still twined in my hand, his sinewy fingers like twigs in the tree we climbed the first day. As soon as I jumped from the car and hugged them, each a small oomph, they rushed me to climb their tree, maple in the jumbled wild green strip of land between houses and lawns. Up, feet there, there's the nest, rumpled, suspended. They long for the hidden bird. We talk about what I can't remember, nothing but words. We drop seeds into light, translucent, silent whirligigs. Better than copters, they say, and gently rock the branch I sit on with their long scratched legs. They have asked me into their tree, and satisfied, we sit rather large in its airy room. Their house slides away across the lawn to the edge. Now we are in the middle. Now they show me the inside. If I see a small grass motion, it's probably voles. That muddy excavation will be dug bigger, longer, for a cave, for a hideout with a tin roof. And all paths, distinct or vague in the rank weeds, go places. The oldest leads me to his, a pond sunk, hedged, and forgotten. No one else comes. He watches in the morning, silver, in the evening, gold. For what? For the birds, to be the one who sees and takes the bird away, but only with his eyes. The youngest boy takes me to the smallest creek. We see the crawfish towers squiggled in the mud. We see dim passageways down to hidden creatures, mysteries. We follow scarce water under a road into sun. They show me jewelweed, touch me not, dangling red-orange tiny ears, and the brown pods, how seed rattles and springs and scatters if you fling out your hand, even carelessly. They show me everything, saying, with no words, they have thought of me here, and here I am with them in the in-between places. Got a little emotional.
I think you're unmuted. I think you're good to go, Kitty.
Okay. Hello, everyone. You can hear me, right? Yes?
Yes. Loud. Okay. Powerfully and clear.
Thank you so much for organizing this and inviting me to be part of it. I'm very honored. I wrote this for my best friend, Anita Onyang. She died in 1986, and I still miss her. It's called The Sound of Waves. The sound of waves is the sound of your voice across mountains, miles, freeways, from Bali to the caverns of my ear. Sunrise to sunset to sunrise, goodness surrounds you. Nothing will harm you. My arms around you. I want to read something from Michio Fukaya, a young Japanese American who I had the fortune of corresponding with for a short time because she took her life at age 30. I am woman, eternal child, creatrix. I am a man bound by the mechanics of my making. Bear with me for a second or 2 seconds. Okay, this poem I wrote for Ilana Deichelman. May her name forever be a blessing. My name is Dyke Woman. My butt dialed her number, a friend at the end of her life. How does one talk? What to say? She's sick, she's asleep. She answers the phone. Flustered, I say sorry, didn't want to disturb. Did I tell her how I enjoyed our lunches? On parting, I would always say, see you again. The Chinese goodbye. Using Chinese, I say goodbye. See you again. Did I tell her my surprise seeing her name for the first time? Who calls themselves Dyke Woman? I exclaim. She's a dyke. She's a woman, a sister. So am I. See you again. Sorry, didn't want to disturb. Two, my name is Dyke Woman. Spell it correctly, W-O-M-O-N with a capital W. Okay. This, you know, I don't want to say this is what happens when you're getting old, but I am old. I finally accepted that. You know, I used to say, well, I'm, you know, older. Well, okay, I'm 71. I am an old lesbian who's still going strong. For all you young ones. You rise in memory of Alana Dyke Woman. May her name forever be a blessing. And Susan Levenkind. May her name forever be a blessing. You rise. You rise from your seat, stride across the stage, and introduce the keynoter to thunderous applause. You, I spotted early on, a woman on your arm. She had blue hair, a radiant smile on her face and in her eyes. You, I spotted early on, greeting attendees with a handshake, a hug. Women talking, women laughing. You, I spotted early on in a dark tailored suit. So smart you looked and handsome, a handsome Butch Dyke. Seasons change as time moves, constant as the tide. Seasons move as time changes, constant as the tide. Boxes unpacked, desk organized, memories unfurled, secrets unlocked, fantasies unfettered, mysteries revealed. Through a mist of silence, the doorbell rings to the barking of dogs. May there be hope in restoration and rebirth. May there always be hope in restoration and rebirth. May you rise. May you always rise. Powerful words. The words of Leslie Feinberg. This was a small sweatshop with a company union, and I was the only he/she in the plant. If this were a big plant, I would be one of many he/she's. So many, we would have our own baseball or bowling teams at work. We're the shirts within the factory complex. There, I would probably have bound my breasts at work, worn a white t-shirt with no jacket, and found my place among our own smaller societal structure within the life of the plant. But despite the fact I hadn't yet been initiated into this society, kindnesses were not withheld. At lunch, I bought a bottle of pop from the machine near the time clock, sat down on a skid to eat my bologna sandwich. Muriel, one of the older native women who worked near me on the line, offered me half her apple. I stood and thanked her. I ate. Each morning for the next week, Muriel offered me coffee from her thermos. Everyone watched us, weighing everything they could observe. I'm going to end with more powerful words. It was hot that night, almost unbearable to sleep. The air pressure and humidity made it difficult to breathe. Thunder rumbled in the distance. I thought about how my life was changing in little ways and big ways. I fell asleep. Lightning bolts streaked the sky. I had this dream. I walked across a vast field. Women and men and children stood on the edges of the field looking at me, smiling and nodding. I headed toward a small round hut near the edge of the woods. I had a feeling I had been in this place before. There were people who were different, like me, inside. We could all see our reflections in the faces of those who sat in this circle. I looked around. It was hard to say who was a woman, who was a man. Their faces radiated a different kind of beauty than who was a woman, who was a man. Their faces radiated a different kind of beauty than who was a woman, who was a man. Their faces radiated a different kind of beauty than I'd grown up seeing celebrated on television or in magazines. It's a beauty one isn't born with, but must fight to construct at great sacrifice. I felt proud to sit among them. I was proud to be one of them. A fire burned in the center of our gathering. One of the oldest in the circle caught my eyes. I didn't know if she was a man or a woman at birth. She held up an object I understood. I was supposed to accept the realness of this object. I looked more closely. It was a ring I had seen before. I had been given as an infant. She pointed to the circle on the ground, the ring cast on the ground. I nodded, acknowledging that the shadow was as real as the ring. I recalled my neighbor Ruth asking me recently, if I had my life to live all over again, would I make the same decision? Yes, I answered unequivocally, yes. I'm so sorry it's had to be this hard, but if I hadn't walked this path, who would I be? At the moment, I felt at the center of my own life, the dream still braided like sweet grass in my memory. I remember Duffy's challenge. Imagine a world worth living in, a world worth fighting for. I closed my eyes and allowed my hopes to soar. I heard the beating of wings nearby. I opened my eyes. A young man on a nearby rooftop released his pigeons like dreams into the dawn. Powerful words, of course, from Leslie Feinberg. I just want to say thank you. Thank you for being here. Thank you for being part of our queer nation, lesbian nation. I had stuff to say, but I just want to say to Leslie and Minnie Bruce, thank you for your words. Thank you for your work. Thank you for your footprints that I, a humble lesbian writer, I will step into your footsteps and move forward. Thank you for your shoulders that are so broad. We stand on your shoulders. And we will continue the work. Thank you so much.
Hi, everyone. I'm tremendously moved by this program. And I find it absolutely impossible to close out a program like this. So I wanted to put forth a few openings, beginnings from the work of Minnie Bruce Pratt and Leslie Feinberg, two poems and two paragraphs. The first poem is from Inside the Money Machine, which Suzanne mentioned earlier. This is an exercise I do with my students. I ask them to find their heart poem from every collection that we read. And this is mine from Inside the Money Machine by Minnie Bruce Pratt. It came out in 2011, and this poem is called Eating Alone. Eating alone. This is a strange way to live, in two or three places at once. And where I am, no one knows that. but me. So even standing in line at the grocery is a comfort. And before that, rolling the cart up and down the aisles, because at least I'm with other people, foraging for food in the orchard, the field rows, the shelves stacked up with merchandise. In line, I see how the woman in front of me has gathered her supper, ground hamburger, white bread. I don't want that food. I just want someone to turn around, talk to me. How can it be that we are all going to carry our plastic bags out the snapping doors and get in our cars and leave each other? Drive away to eat in twos or threes or one alone, me in a blue room with a map of India to study, a novel open next to three sunflowers in blue plastic bottles on the table, Sunday night and eating alone with no one to talk to about fiction and truth, what exists and how. I know that before my story, there are all the other stories. Whatever place I come to, one of you has been there before. And I guess those final lines are also my heart lines of my heart poem, and they sort of speak to what happened here today, and what happens every time I come back to these writers. I am living in a glorious mezzanine of my life right now. I even have some of my own students and one of my own professors and mentors in the audience here today. And so it feels really good to be able to pay forward what my mentors taught me to my own students, to share their work. And all week I was trying to figure out what could I read in such a short time. So I picked the opening paragraph to an essay by Minnie Bruce Pratt and one by Leslie Feinberg that live in old course packs from my earlier days teaching women and gender and sexuality studies at the University of Louisville. Who am I if not my father's daughter? Many of you know this essay by Minnie Bruce Pratt. It dates back to 1984. It was always a heart essay of my Cultures of America class. And it was the first essay that really helped me reckon with privilege and intersectionality and responsibility. So this is just the opening in that theme. As a white woman raised small town, middle class, Christian in the deep South, I was taught to be a judge of moral responsibility and punishment only in relation to my ethical system, was taught to be a preacher, to point out wrong and tell others what to do, was taught to be a martyr, to take all the responsibility for change and the glory, to expect others to do nothing. Was taught to be a peacemaker, to mediate, negotiate between opposing sides because I knew the right way. When I speak or speak up about anti-Semitism and racism, I struggle not to speak with intonations, the gestures, the assumption of these roles, and not to speak out of any role of ought to. I ask that you try not to place me in that role. I am trying to speak today to women like myself, out of need, as a woman who loves other women passionately and wants us to be able to be together as friends in this unjust world. And in my upper level interdisciplinary course that brought humanities and women and gender studies together, I was really lucky to get to teach that course when I was just a PhD student. One of my favorite essays of all time is We Are All Works in Progress by Leslie Feinberg. So I'm gonna give you that opening paragraph as another beginning, and I hope obviously you'll seek out these essays to read them again. You probably already know them. The sight of pink, blue, gender-coded infant outfits may grate on your nerves, or you may be a woman or a man who feels at home in those categories. trans liberation defends you both. Each person should have the right to choose between pink or blue tinted gender categories, as well as all the other hues of the palette. At this moment in time, that right is denied to us. But together, we could make it a reality. And there's this beautiful ellipsis, right? And the essay goes on and asks us to be a part of it. In the spirit of that solidarity and also all the other inspiring writers and activists and advocates who we've invoked today, I wanted to invoke Stacey Waite, who was a couple years ahead of me in my MFA program, who's been a friend and a guiding force in sort of my, I guess, generation of queerness. And I was waiting for years for Stacey's book, Butch Geography, which had been her thesis at Pitt, to find its way into the world. And it did very beautifully in 2013. Butch Geography also contains my favorite homage to Leslie Feinberg. So I thought I would close with Stacey's poem. Once a long time ago, actually the summer of 2010, and Dr. Fossil, my mentor, Kate Fossil's in the audience, she was on my dissertation committee and we got to spend a summer on this book, a directed study on this project, just reading and writing and talking about Stone Butch Blues. And then Stacey went and wrote the most perfect homage. So thank you again to Sandy and Teresa and for everyone who's here. This is Reading Stone Butch Blues for Leslie Feinberg by Stacey Waite. When the men rape you in the schoolyard, I open my high school yearbook and cut out the faces of girls I wanted to love. I let the sink run for hours, tip over the bookcases, melt away the candles in defiance of lovers who insist on lighting up the body. When drag queens take you in like their firstborn son, I go out into the autumn air and rake the dying leaves from the grass. I fill black trash bags, pretend I don't live here when the postman comes. When you land your first job at a factory, tuck your breasts away like laundered money, I polish all the tables, call my mother. When they break your jaw, my voice explodes into stars. My hands become honeycombs, and my mouth an untrained soldier. But the stars I make freeze up. And all I can do is thank you, sweet father, for my life. Thank you, everyone.
Oh. Yeah, I know how you feel, Julie. Ending the program. So I'm like, how am I gonna end it now after hearing you? And after hearing this most prismatic, just beautiful array of voices. We're gonna see a slideshow to end the program, and I will come back with an opportunity. I will be invoking the names of all of our readers one last time and having you all unmute and show your gratitude. So please, the slideshow is short. You will love seeing these images of Leslie and Minnie Bruce together in all of their glory and work. And then let's come back for a final moment of appreciation. Thank you, Kim Ports Parsons. I love that. I love that one picture. Oh, I want to thank Kim Ports Parsons for putting that slideshow together. Such just beautiful, beautiful images of them together. And you can really, really feel their love for each other. It just comes through in every glance. In every glance, it's and to be in their presence, you felt it too. And I want to also say, I feel like, I just feel they've blessed us today. I hope that they've been listening and feel so happy that all of you are continuing to do the work, that because each one of you here has been doing that work, and you, as Kitty was saying, we're standing on their shoulders and we're doing it. We're doing it. And we'll continue to do it. Gratitude is too minuscule a word for me to offer, and how I feel about each of our featured readers today. Nonetheless, I want to take a moment and to thank each one of you. We began the hour, well, the hour and a half, the hour and a little more than an hour and a half. Liz All, Shinny Chen, Kai Coggin, Suzanne Gardiner, J.P. Howard, Jenny Johnson, Yeva Johnson. Ooh, that flute. Oh my gosh. Keisha Kuipers, thank you for, again, holding it down in the Northwest. Beautiful. Mary Miriam, what can I say? Thank you. Kitty Sue, what an incredible, powerful, powerful, powerful force you are. And Julie Marie Wade, because you are the last of the alphabet, always, except I'm a Y. So if we were in the same room, I'd actually be after you. Never forget, you might close us out, but oh my gosh. I want you to be my closer every single time. Folks, as I often do here on Cultivating Voices Live Poetry, would you grace us by unmuting yourselves and showing your...
Sandy, y'all. Sandy.
That's right, Sandy.
Yes. Thank you, Sandy.
Thank you. Fantastic MC, host with the most.
Thank you, everyone.
There's a lot of hosts in here. With
that's
a lot
right.
Of hosts.
Thank you to everybody.
You're one of them, JP. Oh my gosh.
That's right.
Oh, behind the scenes.
Thank you, Gordon. Thank you
everyone.
Gordon Ferris and Gary Lilly and Max Vandersteen, my buddies, brothers, I haven't seen for a long time. And then my first time back to Cultivating Voices in 3 months. Glad to
see you here. Folks, nice. You have been joining us for In Remembrance, Minnie Bruce, a tribute to Minnie Bruce Pratt and Leslie Feinberg. If you were not familiar with their works before, you have received the most glorious of educations today. Our illustrious, our amazing constellation today has done them proud. Has done them proud and done all of us proud and done us an amazing, amazing service in sharing your words in solidarity, in your activism, in your beauty, in your grief and joy. It has been an honor to host the program today. It has been an honor to co-host with Risa Denenberg of Headmistress Press. We thank the press for their work. Of course, co-founders Mary Miriam and Risa Denenberg. I look forward, of course, to seeing you all next week when we will be having our Poets Focus. Folks, the word is ode. Bring your odes to the program. And we will be having our new book showcase, as I mentioned, October 10th with Yeva Johnson will be one of our featured new book showcase folks. So please join us then. And as I always say at the end of every program, my friends, my beloveds here in this room, well, take good care of yourselves. Take exceptional care of your beloveds. Take exceptional care of your beloveds. And of course, do what Minnie Bruce and Leslie did in the face of all the things they faced and all the things that each of you in each of these squares faces. Keep writing, just keep writing. I will see you next Sunday or wherever I see you. It's been an honor and I love all of you. Be well.